Welcome to the Energy Podcast. I'm Eddie, and on today's episode, we're going to dive into the future of what energy could look like. On our last episode, we talked about the energy system, the energy transition, and where we are right now. Today, we're looking forward, talking about the exciting future of energy and discussing the forward-facing world that is Shell scenarios. We're joined by Peter Wood, Shell's Chief Energy Advisor, someone who's had a career spanning from engineering to energy advising and is a key member of the Shell Scenarios team. We'll also be joined by Dr. Mallika Ishwaran, Shell's Chief Economist, who's also a key member of the Shell Scenarios team. I've asked her a couple of questions and we'll fold her answers in as we go throughout. Just a quick note, before we start, when we say Shell or we're talking about Shell PLC and its subsidiaries in general. The companies in which Shell PLC directly and indirectly owns investments are separate legal entities. Let's get into it. And Peter, to start, for those that aren't aware, Shell has a long history of scenarios. What do we mean by that and why do we make them?
Yeah, thanks, Eddie. Yeah, indeed, we've been making scenarios for about 50 years. And what we're trying to do is really understand what the future might look like. We're not trying to forecast and we're not trying to predict. We're trying to sort of portray what the breadth of uncertainty might look like going out 30, 40, 50 years. And why do we do that? It's because the business that Shell's in and the things that we build have a very long life and maybe around in 30 or 40, 50 years' time.
And just to be really clear there, the Shell scenarios, they're not predictions. They're not expectations of what will happen or what probably will happen. They're not expressions of Shell strategy. They're not Shell's business plan. They're one of the many inputs that Shell uses to make decisions, right?
That's exactly right. We're trying to look at a range of possible futures. Some of them are what I would call normative. So they're a sophisticated goal-seek exercise. What would need to happen to achieve a certain outcome, e.g. net zero 2050? Other scenarios are more exploratory, and they riff off the trends that we see today and view and propagate those out to what the future might look like. In the early 1970s, the scenario team sort of came about and had a bit of success, sort of, I wouldn't say predicted some of the oil crises, but it certainly primed Shell's management at the time that there may be oil crises. And when they came along, I think we were maybe in a better position to handle them.
So, Peter, over those 50 years that we've been making scenarios, are they just for us? Or are we the only ones that use them?
I think in the beginning, Shell was a little bit on its own doing it, but we see more and more people building scenarios now. We produce our scenarios for our own internal work, but we've been sharing them for a very long time. It's a tool for helping the company engage. But you now have a number of organizations that make scenarios. I think maybe one thing that separates Shell scenarios from others is that we have a very clear narrative, but we also have an underlying model, techno-economic optimization, that sort of keep each in check. Many scenarios you see out there are either a modeling effort or they're a narrative effort. You can't do that. You need both.
How are scenarios developed? We asked Mallika to help us with this question.
Well, scenarios are genuinely a multidisciplinary effort. The process of developing the scenarios draws on, firstly, the knowledge and expertise in energy markets and energy modeling. It incorporates economics, whether that is the macroeconomic context for the scenarios or the economics around specific technologies, policies, or behavior change. And finally, it brings in the geopolitical lens that is so essential when thinking about energy. And it is a combination of these different perspectives that provides that richness to our scenarios.
So, Peter, the latest report, the 2025 Energy Security Scenarios, published a few weeks back. What prompted Shell to develop it now?
We developed the first two energy security scenarios in 2022, following events in Europe, and they were published in 2023. And there was a normative scenario there. Sky, which has since been renamed Horizon, and Archipelagos. And it became evident in the last year or so that there was potentially a new credible scenario there, which we are now calling Surge. And that's basically looking at the potential impact of artificial intelligence on the energy system, and in particular, how AI could increase productivity, economic productivity, leading to a larger economy, and that would then drive a larger energy system.
And before we dive into the three specific scenarios, when you pick up the report and you read through, what would you find in the overall report?
Well, we spend more time on Surge in the report, and we're really looking to explore what AI can and cannot do to the energy system. And we're also looking at sort of the trends that we've seen firm up in the last 2 years. So you'll see in there, for example, quite a lot of emphasis on solar and batteries because they're proving to be really quite impactful. But you'll also see the scenario still has quite a lot of oil and gas in it because we're not really seeing the energy system move away from those fuels just yet.
So, Peter, if you could, let's step through those three scenarios. We'll start with archipelagos.
Yeah, archipelagos is what you call a fragmentation scenario, a geopolitical fragmentation scenario, where different countries, different regions maybe don't get along as well as they have in the past. So you get a little bit less trade, a little bit less spread of technology. Then we move to the horizon scenario. That is a normative scenario that looks at what needs to happen to reach net zero 2050. So we've engineered our models to reach that target. It's not a forecast. It's just saying this is what we think might need to happen. And then, of course, we've got the surge scenario.
You just mentioned surge. We asked Mallika to tell us more about it.
Now, surge is a techno-optimistic scenario. AI and advanced digitalization technologies are assumed to realize their potential to boost economic growth and to boost economic productivity. So this is a scenario with higher economic growth compared to horizon and archipelagos. Now, the proliferation of this technology is based on technological advances and efficiency improvements that drive down costs and help to make it a general purpose technology with wide applications across different economic sectors and different types of activities. Now, the impact of AI and advanced digitalization is not likely to be uniform across different countries and regions. Now, in terms of specifically looking at the energy system, this technology raises energy demand, particularly electricity demand. But it also has the potential to drive efficiencies and to optimize this energy demand down the road.
Peter, I really appreciate the insights from you and Mallika about the different scenarios. And we've heard about three fairly different ones. Is it possible to say which one we're in or where we're headed?
Everybody wants to turn a scenario into a forecast, and that's not what we do. I think you can see aspects of all three scenarios sort of featuring the world we're in now. You have some countries that are striving hard to reach net zero, and they're exhibiting some aspects of horizon. On the other hand, if you read the newspapers and you can see that there's global tensions, not everybody's getting along, that will be archipelagos. And then equally, if you look at particularly what's going on in the United States, there is a big push to build data centers and drive artificial intelligence forward, and that is having a impact on energy demand.
How do these scenarios help a company like Shell prepare for what's coming forward? We asked Mallika to help us out with that.
Now, the purpose of these scenarios is then to support better decision-making within Shell. For example, considering the different opportunities and challenges created by these different visions of the world helps make better and more resilient decisions.
Peter, do you have anything that you would want to add to that?
Recognizing the range of uncertainty, what you're really trying to do is set your company up for success in a very wide range of future outcomes. So our scenarios help inform our management in that. Lots of other things do as well. And as time evolves, we will adjust and the business will adjust.
Going back in time, Peter, is there a particular scenario that's near and dear to your heart or a favorite?
I think we had a scenario about 15 years ago called Scramble.
Okay.
And let's say the child of Scramble is probably archipelagos. And I think, over the last 15 years, we have seen some aspects of Scramble. At the time, we also had another scenario called Blueprints, the idea that the world will be very organized in how it addresses climate change, and that sort of morphed into Horizon. It's less evident that that's happening. But as I say, it's like having children. You don't have a favorite child. You shouldn't have a favorite scenario. You should look to learn from all of them.
Peter, thank you so much for your time. As to you, Mallika. And thank you for joining us on this bonus episode of the Energy Podcast. Remember, you can find Shell's cautionary note in the show notes. Follow us on social media, click the like button, and don't forget to subscribe however you get your podcasts. Thank you again, and we'll see you next time.